At the beginning, you don't have any software. Then you organize your teams, you organize your corporate, you organize your communication and processes, and you create a software. Then that software evolve with your organization. But if you wanted to change, for example, you do an agile transformation on the legacy system, you have to change also the legacy system itself. Otherwise, you are not able to do a feature team because you have a monolith behind the IT, inside the IT system. And at the end, you have to create a component team to manage this monolith. Then, starting from the two roles, you at the end, you have to evolve together corporate organization, IT system. Otherwise, if you do just the cloud native transformation about your legacy or legacy modernization, monolith split, and you don't organize your corporate in an agile way, or you do an agile organization, but you have a monolith and you don't evolve your monolith, at the end, the cost is increased because you are not able to manage your system because the system have another way to communicate with components instead of feature. The bottlenecks become more and more frequent and the quality decrease. This is a point of attention. Then you need to evolve both. Otherwise, you just do agile as a tool, but without any benefit. Then you need a radical shift. You need a radical shift from infrastructure-centric approach to the developer-centric vision. Then we call it developer experience. Francesco will go in depth about the developer experience and how we can approach it.
Okay, thanks, Giulio. So a radical shift. And where this radical shift is starting? First of all, following the best practice of DevOps organization, is important to change the responsibility. So the feature teams itself should have the control of when and how to move and deploy their functionality. And this is particularly relevant if you are adopting microservice style, where you have an independent component, and so you need to put them together frequently in order to test the interaction. So that is a very central point to empower the fact that the approach is self-service and independent. The second way is predicted by Gartner, and this is something that we are facing today in some early adopter organization, is important to connect not only the development of code part, but also provide to that team some increasing control in terms of infrastructure automation. So the possibility to start up, to request your new infrastructure functionality, and that is made very simple and effective with the cloud progression of vendor infrastructure services and so forth. So in some way, you have to combine continuous delivery of the application and automation of configuration of the infrastructure. Performing this, we experience that in some way there are a standard common maturity journey that organizations are facing. They typically start with having no DevOps, no Agile, not automation of infrastructure in place. And then they tend to approach the new journey, the new way, with an initial forerunner team. So please click, Giulio. This is the typical starting point. So it's not the majority or the large part of the organization that is testing the new way, but there are some small teams initial area. And initially, this team worked very well because developer and operation guys are combined in the same team. So there is a real DevOps in terms of a single team. And they tend to be the one that build the infrastructure, the platform, the tool they need. Moving away. So this for a runner team feel a very good developer experience. There are some lack in terms of governance and standardization, but this at the beginning is not emerging. So there are a lot of pro that are high quality, out autonomy, and good developer experience. Sooner or later, the teams must grow, the adoption of that style and that infrastructure became more mainstream, and some problems are emerging. Typically is slow, the capability of start a new team or a new initiative. It's not smooth to onboarding someone team member in the initial existing team. If you proceed with autonomous team, you lack in terms of standardization, you lose a clear governance, and there is a very poor knowledge sharing among experience performing in different team. So this is a good way to start, but this model need to be adjusted in order to support this approach as a main stream majority of your infrastructure. So typically organization in the second ages of this journey tend to perform a sort of separation and standardization rule. So they define some corporate guideline, they standardize the adoption of some style for the pipeline, they centralize the operators team people, so the DevOps people, and they tend to providing access to that centralized team via a ticket system or service. Some portal start to present documentation on how to configure pipeline are put in place. And there are some approach by opportunity to putting in place alert metrics, monitor. So there is not a real possibility for the future teams to self-serve what they need in that situation. So this is second stage. One click, Giulio, please. Is in some way characterized by the rule of standardization and governance. And there are some pro in this phase that are the quality, average quality of the code developed, because there is a governance and there is a standardization. Some automation start to be put in place in terms of infrastructure. And this style is suitable or is feasible to scale up, so to deal with some or multiple team. What are the problem? The problem is that you dramatically are suffering a loss on autonomy for the team member, and you start having a poor developer experience compared to the initial one. So the risk of bottleneck and friction among the division of developer and operation are emerging, and scale is still possible, but in some way become expensive. So the number of operator people you need to have to face the request of developer is not in the perfect combination. So you will have some complexity in your organization. And typically the complexity are correlated to the fact you have multiple point solutions. So you need to ask developer to jump from one tool to the other in their activity and their journey. So this model at the end of the day create a segregation that detach the dev part from the ops part. So sooner or later became urgent to remove this new barrier and wall, and the adoption of an internal dev portal is a way that allow the organization to cross in, to move forward to this new barrier. So summarizing the key reason and limit of help desk approach that forced the switch, we can think at DevOps tool chain is some way as some sort of challenge in term to put together multiple dispersed tool. So in order to have a development environment for microservices and API, you need at least repository, some one or more tool for the pipeline. You need to have some place where you have the artifact. You need a system for performing tracking and collecting the log. You need to have some system for metering the infrastructure consumption and to allow the team to investigate area of potential problem, slowdown, and risk. That's our different things. That's typically our multiple point solution. So using different low level functionality, and this create complexity and cost. And the team member are struggling to obtaining what was the main purpose of approaching the feature teams approach. So reduce time to market and reduce constraints and lack of visibility. So end to end capability and functionality. So organization in some way need to think about relay on a tool that present a single house, a single place where the teams can have a self-service approach and accountability, traceability, observability of the entire cycle of DevOps. That is the situation that you can reach adopting a developer portal. So the standardization still in place, but the experience for developers is way better, relying on a self-service approach, having the possibility to start and control some aspect on the infrastructure, and basing the functionality and development on the approach of template that cover and embrace also alert and metrics, and also drive some good style, good practice in term of accountability and full control on all the aspects of the features. Giulio, I pass to you the presentation in term of functionality. Any questions so far?
Okay, I will mute.
Okay, go ahead, Giulio.
There is a chat, no? You can raise your hand, okay, no, sorry. just check the chat. Okay, then let's try to imagine that your end user is not the B2C user that buy a book on the Amazon, but is a developer. And the developer need to have a very simple experience, and the team also have a very simple experience, is self-service. They don't have to ask anything to the corporate, to the organization, to the company. They have just to click, just to write a command line and create the cluster, deploy, and so on. This is internal developer portal that help people to be satisfied by their works and help teams to be very effective during the job. Let's try to starting with the developer portal from the vision, then I go step by step to check every single area of the developer portal. Then you have the feature team, you have a developer portal that help people to manage the complete life cycle of the DevOps, from the infrastructure management to the microservice configuration, deployment, dashboard, monitoring and logs, debugging, documentation, reuse of API and events with a marketplace. And you have a big landscape of open source technologies or technologies that you have to master to manage this kind of IT application. Because we don't more speak about the monolith, but we are going to speak now about a cloud native application that is fragmented between several different microservices that collaborate together to create a business logic and an end user service. Then this is the developer portal where teams live during the project execution. Let's say the one part of very important part is the infrastructure. When a new project starts in a help desk organization, this part, just to understand, it is help desk. What when you start a project, you need to define the architecture and ask to operation teams to create the cluster with this capacity plan, to create the pipelines and to expose the DNS, create a certificate, and so on. The idea behind the internal developer portal that all of this provisioning is self-service for the developer team. The developer team can create by itself the infrastructure following the standard of the organization. Then the operation team, like Amazon, Google in the cloud, as a cloud vendor, you don't know when you create your Linux box on AWS, who is in charge of managing the IaaS self-service infrastructure. You just do create your, you the action, create your Linux box. And in that way, also the internal developer portal for the company, you just, as a developer, you are the end user for the infrastructure. You can create your cluster by self-service. You can manage your secrets, username and password for connecting to the databases. You have a unique authentication authorization model for all infrastructure part of your application. You have a centralized audit log. Then everything you do, every action you perform on the infrastructure is audited for also for GDPR reason. You have an updates by self-service updates. For example, the database needs an update, a security patch. You are highlighted that you need to update that database. You click and update the database. You don't have to ask to another department to update that database. It's a service. The scaling of the infrastructure is automatically performed by the infrastructure itself. You have automatic backup with the retention. You have just configure your retention schema. All everything is monitored. You have also alerts if something doesn't work correctly in your infrastructure. You have also the cost. It's very important to keep under control cost, and you may have also advices for saving cost if you are using more less infrastructure that you have created. And a way to save cost, also share the infrastructure in a multi-tenancy way. This is the part for the developer portal that simplify the developers, the usage of all aspects of the infrastructure IT systems. A lot of people that do are developers don't like to do operational stuff, and vice versa. Also, operational guys don't like to do developer. The idea is that you create a infrastructure service platform that help developer to do the job without asking anything to the operation guys. This is very is a streamline and time to market accelerator for your team. Another part is the design. When you create a cloud native application, you have to design the architecture, the approach, you have several different microservices styles, from Saga patterns to backend for frontend and so on. And you want to reuse some pattern for the future application. The idea is that you can do everything by yourself, from the configuration about the config maps, the testing on no prod environments, the exposure of the APIs and the events, the security aspects is very important to have under control. Also, another part is the versioning. If you are using approach like trunk-based with feature toggle, all feature branches. How are you using SAMVER for versioning your application or not? All of these aspects is very important that is standardized by the internal developer portal. That way, every team use the same approach for versioning. And also, when you aggregate more services together to create a product, the product version is clear for all teams and also for the company. And if you want to share your knowledge inside your company, you can just publish on the marketplace your microservice, your source code, and someone in another team can reuse your knowledge base and create another application starting from your source code. In that case, you have a marketplace very easy to contribute and to use. And the second part of the internal developer portal is the design part to create your microservice and republish your microservice for reuse from other teams. The other part is the deployment. When you go, when you deploy your service, you need to deploy in runtime environments that are not production or production environments. And a lot of time I see companies that have a big issue in this part of, in this phase of the software lifecycle, because you need to open a ticket, you need to pass the link of the artifact that the other department should deploy, you need to say in which environment you have to deploy, and the department, operational department, have to point to the correct cluster and configure the cluster according to your needs. The idea is that you don't have to bother about the cluster, about the infrastructure, you just point to the environment, to the runtime environments, not production or production environment, and just click and see what happened. You can, for example, tag the deployment, say, okay, if this deployment works well, otherwise I can do the rollback in the deployment. And I can also dry run the deployment phase to try and understand if I'm going to deploy this configuration of set of microservices, what happened in this runtime environment? What are the differences between the runtime that is running right now and what I'm going to deploy if I click the button? This is everything that is very useful for the development team to be autonomous during the deployment phase. Another very important part is that you can do a lot of tests, but the real test is in production. If you have the autonomous do production tests in production environment without impacting your end user, you are very, very effective in your software application. Another very important part is trace everything that is done in the deployment phase and deployed in the runtime environments must be tracked in the who is have done a deployment, when, and what is has been deployed. Also, an important part is create automatically release notes from the deployment. When I click deploy, also have the release notes and put in the documentation. This new version is live. This all the new feature or bugs resolved for this version is very useful for the team. When you deploy an application in production, you need to guarantee the business continuity. Have automatically dashboard for all services is very, very important. Also for alarms is very critical, because if you need a 24/7 application that is business critical, alarms is a good way to mitigate the risk of downtime. Logs, when you have in trouble, well, when you are in trouble, have accessible very quickly, the log is very important for the team. Otherwise, should ask, can you send me a zip file with the log for this service, blah, blah, blah? Instead, in the internal developer portal, logs are just a click away from the team. Business metrics: how many tickets I sold today, which is the rate of tickets per minutes, is a good way to measure the status of your application and create alarms also for business performance. And the other part is important, the uptime status of your system. As you are used to see this kind of dashboard on cloud vendors, but also for your application, it's very important to monitor the status and the uptime, because your end user, if he's aware that your system doesn't work, is much more easy for him to her to postpone the action and wait that when the system is up again, because is notified that the system doesn't work. Instead, if she doesn't know if the system works or not, she tried to click on your application until it come back again. Then is a way to be transparent with your end user. Another part is also security. Are notified about the security patches, they're critically important for the team. The last part is this knowledge sharing. You have created your infrastructure, you have designed your services, you have deployed your service, you are monitoring your service, but you need also to share your know-how with other teams and for onboarding for the new team members and to expose your service for future user inside or outside your company. The internal developer portal should have also a documentation part. We suggest to have a Git-based documentation approach where you can contribute using a pull request method on documentation itself. The documentation can be automatically composed also reading the API specification, the event schema, and that way you can publish very quickly the updates of your references architecture. Can be updated automatically if you have, for example, 100 microservices in your repository, and each microservice have a readme.md file where is described how to use the service, how to contribute to this service. You can create a document portal that collects every readme in just one place. And every time the readme is updated, the document portal is updated itself. Is a good way to for new team member. You can see here in this example, getting started. When a new team member enters in your company, just click here and is a guideline how to contribute to the system, how to create a service, how to expose, how to use the internal developer portal. Is a good way to share know-how. And you can also use this documentation to create your guidelines, for example, for branching strategy, for versioning strategy, and so on. Another part is very important is create example. We are used to use Stack Overflow as an example source, but also internally you can create your Stack Overflow and create some example to that are very useful for newbie to starting coding with new technology or use your system for doing something. Very, very interesting part is it works very well. Very important is also create diagrams about architecture in one place. The document part, the company developer portal documentation part is the half of the knowledge of the system. And it is tied together with all DevOps lifecycle. That's it. The idea is that you have a self-service portal where teams can work in the complete lifecycle of the microservice ecosystem. Takeaways, Francesco.
Okay, so we are at the end. What are the lessons learned of, or we hope to be transferred by our presentation? Cloud native technology open the door for agile feature team organization inside your landscape. Feature team approach is a good way to reduce time to market, to decrease effectiveness of your development. Scaling the team is creating and is putting the risk, the entire benefit that you want to reach. So it's not simple just to say, I want to be organized in feature team. You have to put in place some change in the way you are managing your infrastructure and managing you are controlling your progress in the development. How you can speed up this part? By adoption an internal developer portal that leads to self-service, tech provisioning of team, a better way to enforce governance and good practicing, increase knowledge sharing, and think in terms of reuse and in a common way to approaching the developer, the infrastructure, and the tools that are required. The internal pool market is moving, so are emerging a lot of different providers, MIA platform in one among the others, but there are several different products, tool, commercial wave from open source to intellectual property. So look at it, take care, and be aware of the fact that there is an emerging new way of managing organization and production of digital products. Thanks. I don't know if there are some questions.
I have a question. I think you, Giulio, mentioned the Conway's law, and I was wondering, like, so basically, the structure of the organization influences how you structure your architecture, I guess, the domains of your microservices. So how do you, is there any way to visualize this from, like, visualize this relationship from the tool, or do you have any advices regarding, you know, avoiding weird situation that I've, for example, I've seen situation where there is a small team managing 30 microservices or a big team managing one microservice. So is there anything to help making sure that somehow these two elements that influence each other, they work well together?
Good question, Emanuele. It's not so easy to answer. Let's say the conversation between people and teams help to create I suggest to have a workshop and to try to define your model, your domain model. You can use even storming, for example, to create your domain model and understand the set of the microservices that do something and compose your feature team by feature, by domain models and not by technology, for example. Yeah. Because what I see in my experience is that a lot of time feature team is a technology team because people doesn't know about other technology, then say, we cannot do a feature team because I don't know this technology. Okay, but then it is a component team. It's not more of a feature team. You yeah. don't have the benefit of feature team, and then maybe you have to organize differently your conversation, your communication, your processes. And it is a long journey, and you need to be aware that it's not so easy to create a feature team, and maybe it's not a feature team and it doesn't work every time. Maybe sometime is a good idea. In other time, you have to create other way to not a feature team, but maybe several different teams that collaborate together, but are much more near to a component team because your infrastructure, your application, your architecture doesn't support the feature team itself.
Yeah,
makes sense. To add a point to Giulio's answer, one of the key benefits in my experience of the internal developer portal is also to help to visualize the organization. So creating a common house, I call it common house, so a single place where everything is accessible, allowed to experience and understand and work on the aspects that you, Manuele, mentioned. So there is not a perfect rule in terms of how many team members compared to the size of microservices, or there is no vice versa comparison in terms of transaction and the size of microservices and so on and so forth. But creating a culture of having a visual place of you can access and get this information. Allow the fact that there are control and there are not orphan piece of software that stand in some niche of your infrastructure, and empowering the fact that by convention you create dashboard and report help organization to manage and control the Conway's rule and reverse Conway rules. So in some way, be aware of what's happening.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so by visualizing, by having one single place where you can visualize all this information, updated documentation, the logs and everything, you can possibly spot easier bottlenecks and problems that maybe will make you think, maybe I need to refactor either my architecture or my organization or both.
Correct.
Okay.
Correct.
Thank you. There's a question, I believe, by Federico.
Yes, of course. Okay, just a little disclaimer. Okay, I'm already cooperating with Giulio and Francesco. Okay, so we know each other. So just a little disclaimer. But as a matter of fact, okay, we are transitioning from a component structure in our tech division, in our company, toward a feature teams, okay? And so, of course, we are facing some resistance, both from, let me say, the business side, so those departments that are not the tech department, and internally in the tech department. So my question is, what are 2 points would you leverage with the business department and with the technician to ease the transition, to help them to understand what is the real benefit, and not to focus on the problems, but on the success of the transition?
Giulio, you want to start?
Okay. Just a question. Which problems they rose from the business side and from the technical side?
Okay, both sides. Okay, both sides do not like the idea to change. They think that what they have today is good enough for everything. Okay, but we are facing some difficulties. And many of those difficulties are those that you highlighted during your presentations, okay? We cannot scale up. We tried, but without any results, with some component, okay? This is in the tech department. And there is a lack of shared knowledge across the component. This is another problem. And we have some people who are really they are really high person, so they are really specialized, and so they become bottleneck. So we would like to avoid this, and everybody is protecting their own little spot. Okay. On the other hand, on the business side, same again. They see that, hey, we are doing pretty well now. They believe we are agile, but actually we are doing mini waterfall. You know, they do all the business requirement, then they move on to the design, the user interface and the user experience design, and then everything is passed to tech. Even if we are doing this quickly, is actually a small version of a waterfall approach, okay? Because there is not enough interaction between the various departments. How can we help both tech department and business? What we could leverage to help them understand that we need this shift?
The short answer is just try.
Thank you.
No, because at the end, every company, every organization, starting from the Spotify model that start from the feature team, at the end, they try and change. And the last blog post 2 months ago say, okay, we try, it works for some reason, for other reasons it does work, then now we change. The idea is that is not the goal of the feature team. It's a start to understand that every time we need to change our model, our approach, because the business accelerated and scale up. And my idea is that the short answer is you don't have to be agree about the feature team or not to be agreed about the feature team. You need to be agree that you need to have a process that helps you to change and try every month, every 6 months, your process. You challenge how you work and you improve, and you need to measure the performance, not of the team, but of the business performance, the time to market and so on. And you need to start a Kaizen approach. Let's say an approach that the change, the continuous improvement is very important.
Okay.
And the feature team is a way to say, okay, now we try, we work, we do well, but we can do better. Yes. How we can do better? I don't know. Then we can try different way to do better. And a feature team can be a way. It works after 3 months, 6 months, well. Otherwise, we change again.
Okay.
Federico, I have another suggestion for you. Start of all, surprise me that there is no desire of change coming from business part. So if there is not this request, you are going very well. Typically, the changement is pushed by the fact that the business line see slow time to market, see some difficulty to having the services, the digital product they need. So starting from this, the fact they don't understand why you want to change is a good point to start. I suppose that you are driving the change because of internal cost, because from the other side, you mentioned that some of the bottleneck that you are experiencing are the one we mentioned. So seems to be more an internal problem of the IT department organization in some way. So you want to be more effective in terms of cost side. So you have to face with internal teams resistance to change, and resistance to change is, let me say, a human common way of be, so is quite normal. From the other hand, if you relate to be on some key maven, you are in some way putting at risk your entire organization, so you need to spread the knowledge to reduce the barrier to have a new team member, to simplify the journey of new operation guys, and so on and so forth. So you have to push a little bit the changement, and for the other side, you have to provide benefits. So try to smooth the experience. I suppose that probably the one that move some resistance are the one that in some way are in a good position inside the team. There are probably some others that have not the voice, the presence to be more loud that will emerge by the changes. So will be feel better. So the suggestion of Giulio to try and to adjust is a good way. But also I suggest you to take in consideration also these two parts that I highlighted.
Okay. Thank you very much.
There's another question from Rajiv.
Yeah. Hi, guys. My name is Rajiv. I just want to give you a background. I'm working as a developer in a financial company. So our company decided we want to go cloud native, and they have given all the responsibilities of, in a sense, we have to check whether it is good or not, or basically everything, financially it is good or not, or something like that. We're moving to AWS, and we are very new to this, and our application is not lift and shift. Basically, it is quite monolithic, so we don't have a big picture. We don't know much about AWS. So how to move forward, how we can, drill down, and we can make it as a funnel, how we can go forward. First we need what we need to check, then what we can check. So those parts, I just want to know, how we can move forward with this approach.
Sorry, the move forward from, I tried to figure out and I missed the point. Move forward from which approach?
Approach in the sense, if we are moving, if we are becoming cloud native, and we don't have a better idea, we are very new to AWS, and they have given all the responsibilities.
Your starting point is monolithic.
Yeah, a monolithic.
Yeah, it's a monolithic application. Yeah, it's not simply you can lift everything, all the microservices, and put it in AWS or create an EC2 instances or something like that. So, and we have to check, we have to balance between cost and the basically infrastructure as well. And so I just want to understand how we can start with this thing.
Okay, so I try to answer, Giulio, if you want.
Yeah.
So
yeah,
your journey is the, let me say, common and is very challenging. So you want to divide a monolithic application. There is not a common rule. First of all, you have to consider the transactionality of your business application. If you have a very strong transactionality, having and moving totally to a pure microservice approach is very complex and probably is not create so huge value at the moment. So a first approach I suggest is to identify and select well which area are we getting benefit in terms of using, approaching cloud native textile. Typically are the ones that are close to the touch point, so to the channel. So you don't have to divide and redesign the entire application probably, but you have to expose and to orchestrate and to introduce a layer of microservices that help you to customize and to adjust the backend for frontend, the business rule in terms of channel need.
Mm-hmm.
That is typically the way of approaching it. If you are moving to cloud for efficiency in terms of infrastructure, etc., you can lift and shift some part of your application and start to redesign, rethink the one that I tried to enlighten before, so the one close to that part. So you can have some sort of fat services at the beginning that embrace your core part, and you surround that by some of new microservices that help you to be more effective, more fast in terms of having functionality, for example, on mobile and web, or to support some new applications, some new activity in terms of channel partners, new product, or so on and so forth.
Okay, so you are saying first go with the microservices, and then you can go with remaining monolithic part
you keep some core part monolithic and you start to dismantle to change the part that are closer to your touch point. In order to enter in more detail, we have to understand better the nature of that software and the part that is covered, the functionality, and et cetera.
Okay. Also, Rajiv, I can put you in touch on LinkedIn with Giulio and Francesco. I'm sure if you have some other question, they're happy to help you.
Definitely.
On top of this one, I have a quick question. So is moving from monolith to microservices, is that always a good thing? And also, is there a moment where it's too early to do that? And what are the consequences of doing that too early?
You don't have to move from monolithics to microservices just because you have to.
Right.
Typically, you move to microservices because becoming more, let me say, digital omnichannel is creating some overloading to your monolithic application that generate cost in terms of infrastructure and provide poor quality of services to the new touch point. That's are typically the reason why you are approaching this style, this movement. And the majority of company, large organization are not, transforming the core and the, let me say, standard mature part. So nobody has redesigned, let me say, general ledger in terms of microservices, but they typically have a layer on top of the monolithic part that is able to collect business events, to provide a decoupling layer to support the channel, and they implement in the microservice part what's in the past was in some way the customization on top of core traditional monolithic application.
Okay, yeah, makes sense. Thank you. Any other question? Okay, can I ask one last one? I promise it's the last one, and then I'll let you all go to dinner. I've been working with a team where they were having, not problems, but concerns with, GDPR and other privacy frameworks. But, let's stay on GDPR for now. So I'm wondering, with a developer platform, and maybe specifically with Mia, how is that managed, if it is, in the sense that one example could be, backups are managed by the platform. In the meantime, you get a request for the right to be forgotten, right? So where a user says, delete my profile and my data, but then you've done a backup a few days before, and when you restore the backup, you risk to put the data of the user that has requested their data to be deleted to be back again. One example. Or another example is logs. Logs where you might be putting some personal information, user ID, that you can then use to merge to go into a table, get personal data from that user. So there's a several, not to mention finally, the data sovereignty. So I am in the UK supporting an application in the US. Can I transfer the data? So are these concerns somehow addressed by the developer portal that you know and by Mia?
Okay, another complex question.
Sorry.
No, meetup dei capi che volevo seguire, ma...
Sorry, there is a voice.
Yes, muted.
First of all, internal developer portal and MIA platform among them is not a, let me say, a different way of building all. So the developer portal is providing a unified front end and a sum of tools that automate the activity on low level component. So that's for me important because your question is not, let me say, inside immediately or automatically the way of you are using the dev portal. Obviously, adopting an internal developer portal and the style of organization that we have tried to present allow you to reduce the risk to access, to standardize the way and putting in place functionality that may address this challenge. The two challenges are a little bit different. The first one was related to the backup, I think is the complex one, because in some way the backup is something that you need and is something that put you at risk when you recover. So not in normal way of a common business, but when there is some situation. Typically, the backup is limited in time, so you keep images of your application 15, 13 rolling day. So is reducing in term of having historical data. The risk is exactly what you mentioned. Someone that requests to be removed, and after a problem, you recover an old version of your data storage, and the person is back again in general. That, I think, is the more complicated among the other. The log part is less complicated in some way. You could have policies for anonymizing data in the log, and you don't put this log never back in production. So in some way, you need to keep this log in order to troubleshooting, to understand behavior. So in some way, if you have a good design in terms of what you can log and track, and you have different rules in terms of aging of that role, you can protect from that part. Because probably you need for some day not totally anonymized log, because you want to troubleshoot the situation for a precise customer. So you need their ID, let me say. Obviously not their name or other sensitive information, but the ID at least is some way required. But after a month, probably is very difficult that you have to troubleshooting this precise part of this activity. And in the case when you need this for some rules, etc., you have to control who has access and what sort of visibility you provide on top of that data.
Just to add a little bit for the first answer of Francesco, depends on how you design your application, because if you create an event source model, then you can reapply an event source is a history of commands that you apply on your database. You can restore 3 days ago the database of 3 days ago and reapply all the action, all the commands of 3 days ago. You need also the backup of the commands you apply. But it's not so easy because it doesn't depend about the platform, it depends on the application architecture.
Yeah. Makes sense. Cool. Thank you. Thank you. Very clear.
You're welcome.
Thank you to everybody.
Thank you. Have a good evening. Next time, just a reminder, next week we're going to have impactful retrospectives. So join us if you're interested to the topic. And yeah, thanks everyone for joining. Thanks to our speakers, and talk soon.
Bye-bye. Thanks.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Thank you.
Thank you.